John, the 5th chapter, 3rd verse. I'm sorry, the 5th chapter. We're going to read a few verses of this 5th chapter. Maybe down to verse 9. So we're going to read John 5, 1 through 9. Man, it says, after this there was a feast of the Jews. Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there is at Jerusalem, by the sheep market, a pool, which is called in the Hebrew tongue, Bethesda, having 5 porches. And in these lay a great multitude of impotent folks, a blind, halt, withered, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool and troubled the water. And whosoever then first, after the troubling of the water, stepped in, was made whole of whatsoever disease he had. And a certain man was there, which had an infirmity 38 years. And when Jesus saw him lie, he knew that he had been now a long time in that case. And he said unto him, wilt thou be made whole? And the impotent man answered him, sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me in the pool. But while I am coming, another step down before me. And Jesus said unto him, rise, take up thy bed and walk. And immediately the man was made whole, and took up his bed and he walked. And on the same day was the Sabbath. Amen. And I'm going to take my text from the 6th chapter. When Jesus saw him lie, knew that he had been now a long time in that case, he said unto him, will thou be made whole? My sermon today is, do you want to be fixed?
Amen.
Or do you just want to stay messed up? Do you want to be fixed? Or do you just want to stay messed up? Now, I can see this man, Jesus looking at this man. All this stuff and all this condition he's going through. He didn't hurt him, give his spiel about why he couldn't do this and he can't do that. And Jesus just looked at him. And I can almost hear Jesus saying, in this simply shorter version of, will thou be made whole? Can you imagine Jesus thinking, look, man, do you want to be healed? Or do you just want to stay messed up? That's the only thing I want to know. And on this Father's Day, we have all kinds of problems in our society, particularly with the men. And women aren't far behind. But the men are the people who set the tone, who are responsible for the direction of humanity.
Amen.
God gave it to us, and he told us we were responsible, and it's our job to protect the women and provide for our children.
Amen.
Whether we do it or not, that's something else, but that's not how God set it up. He set it up for us to be the ones who are in charge. You have today all kind of excuses why people can't do what God said do. Now, in some cases, some of them just haven't been taught. They haven't been taught from the Word of God. We're teaching them everything else. We have ungodly people teaching them in schools. They have ungodly parents in their home if they have both parents. They were born into an ungodly situation in that they came in to a home that only had one parent and the people weren't married. Amen. God didn't set it up that way. So naturally you're opening the door for all kinds of problems, which we're seeing. We have people today who are blaming everybody and everything, and they always got an excuse for why they can't. This man was one of those. These excuses, yeah, maybe they might seem legitimate, but he also has some credit because he was there in this situation for a long time. So Jesus is put himself into this scene, this situation where he was going to one of the feasts. It was the 3 feasts that the Jews attended, and Jesus was at this feast. He was there. We don't know which of the 3 that it was. We don't know if it was the Passover or what it was. Although some say that, you know, it could have been they had the Feast of the Pentecost and Tabernacle. More than likely, probably the Feast of the Passover, more than likely. These feasts that they attended or went to, or reason they gathered around, any male that lived within 20 miles of the city of Jerusalem was required to attend these three feasts. It's, no, the scripture says, you know, forsake not the assembling of yourself together. Well, these were the three of all the events that they were required to. It's like some people go to church on Sunday and they don't go to Bible class. Man, even though it's a class, it's, I tell and teach, I think Bible class is more important than Sunday morning service and Sunday school, if your church has one. These are the places where you really learn and get to break down and ask questions. We use Sunday now as a place of celebration mainly. Come in and, you know, everybody want to get their step on, say we had a good time. They like to dance off the music, but they don't want to eat off the table. See, they don't want to sit down on Wednesdays when the hard supper is served. But thank God we don't have that problem here. Now, this pool that Jesus was at where he met this man, they say it was called Bethesda, that is, House of Mercy. It had five porches, and in these porches, everybody was kind of laying around and lounging, and, you know, like a poolside, like you go to a swimming pool at your house, folks are sitting in the deck chairs all around, while the kids are splashing and urinating in the water. Which is why a lot of folks don't get in the pool, public pools. Right. Amen. But so, anyway, so they were at this place, and in here the scripture tells us that lay a great multitude of impotent folks, blind, halt, withered, waiting for the moving of the water. In our lives, we have a lot of great tests and trials. We have a lot of people with a lot of problems among us today, including those in the church, especially sometimes those who are in the church. They're right there in an environment where healing can take place, but a lot of them never receive that healing because they don't accept the word of Jesus Christ. There are things about the word of God that are inconvenient at times. There are things about the word of God that we don't like because they don't fit our lifestyle. They don't fit our thoughts or our personality. What you will find is that when you begin to examine people who say they are in church, they're in the area where you can be healed and fixed, when you start to talk to them, you will find out that their philosophies differ sometimes greatly from the Bible, and many times in ways that are shocking. Now, it's understandable if people haven't been taught. Man, new saints coming in, people who haven't been exposed to the truth, man, come in. Sometimes it takes a while for stuff to sink in. If you think about ourselves, it took a while for stuff to sink in, and some of us still waiting for stuff to sink in. but amen, it has to do with the fact that if you're going to serve God, then you have to have a mindset that is acceptable to the word of God. See, the seed will fall on good ground, some of it will fall on stony ground, and some of it will fall on ground. It'll take root, but it'll wither before the seed even gets a good hold. It'll start to sprout, you'll see good things for them, and the next thing you know, they're gone. Amen. And so they get just enough to think they got it, and then they don't want to grow no more. But see, there's a process that you have to go through. Man, if you're going to learn the word of God, if God's word is going to be in you, and that process starts with Jesus, and it ends with Jesus. It is what he says that should dictate the lives and the choices of an individual. Now, like I said, sometimes it's hard to get through, because here it is, you have the Lord himself, the healer, man, who's at this place where the people all come in with these great needs. These people have traveled, amen, many of them farther than 20 miles. Now, to us, that ain't nothing. We'll go out there and jump in our car, fire it up. We can be at 20 miles away in 15 or 20 minutes with no problem. But some of these people, this was a 2 or 3 day journey. Man, they had to walk, they had to bring their children with them and their families, and some of them had to move their possessions and things because they couldn't leave them because amen, they had to bring everything with them. They traveled with what they owned. And so it's significant that they made this effort to come out. So this man, somehow, people seemed like he could get to the water, but there was nobody to put him in. In other words, it would be like having a church without having a pastor. One of the most amazing things that I have seen is the process that people go through, amen, in choosing pastors. It's like an argument. It's almost like a family argument sometimes, and folks leave the church, and it's one of the worst things, because you have people who don't have a shepherd over them for the period of time, and what it is I'm doing is breaking up the church. And there is no reason and no excuse why a church shouldn't have a smooth transition process. Man, one man dies, there should be somebody already there, ready to step in. It's inexcusable. But see, according to the word of God, what they would do is somebody in authority would appoint and say, here's your pastor, or they would plan. Because, amen, when Moses passed away, the children of Israel already knew who was coming next. They already knew who was next in line. You see, it has to do with the brokenness. And that's why I'm asking, man, do you really want to be made whole, or would you just prefer to stay in the condition you were in? There are some people, amen, who I think don't want to change things, even though they know what they have is bad. But they are so afraid, or they have so many excuses. This man said, sir, I don't have anybody when the water is troubled to put me in the pool. But while I'm coming, another stepping down before me. We have in our society children today who are in single parent homes with mothers. And they say that these mothers cannot raise these children. They say that the cause of our society is single parent homes. Yes, that is a part of the ultimate problem. But what they miss is they do not have Jesus figured into the equation.
Right.
You see, because a woman with Jesus can raise a child effectively. She made mistakes in the path of getting those children. That's one thing. But once that person knows the Lord, then God is able to be their mother and their father. And he's able to do these things. And so Jesus has to be figured into the equation.
Amen.
These young men that are running around today doing all this damage in our society. Man, they do say the majority of them, something like 80%+, do come from single parent homes. But this young man, this man here in our story, he had an excuse. He said, there's no man. I have no man. And see, when you don't have no man, you still have Jesus.
Amen.
And sometimes you don't have a man if you got a man. Because you got a big child in many ways. You know, you taking care of him and the children, amen, in many cases. Amen. So, amen, if you don't have no man, you sure better have the Lord. Man, because he can fix it and make it all right. This water, and when the water's troubled, when things are going on, there's nobody to put me into the midst of action. And I don't have anybody to pay for my children's college education. I don't have any way to get a college education. I can't seem to find a job. Nobody will hire me because of my criminal past. Or nobody will do this or do that for me. And so we have men today that have excuses why they cannot, man, succeed. But this man had been in his condition 38 years. He'd been there a long time. Sometimes your troubles and your problems are going to be long-term troubles and long-term problems. And certainly our situation in our society is a long-term trouble and a long-time problem. But I will tell you today that if our society was willing to go back to the Bible and start applying biblical solutions instead of their own, instead of sitting in some college classroom as though going to Harvard University will make you smart. Man, what will make you smart is knowing the Lord. Man, that's what will make you smart. Man, because what going to school sometimes will do is make you a fool before God. Amen. It'll make you a fool standing before, amen, people trying to come up with solutions to problems that God has already solved. So if God has already solved the problem, what are you going to do when you start messing with it? You're going to mess it up. Remind me of when I was a kid for Christmas. I got a toy at one time. Toy was totally 100% complete and intact. And I decided that toy needed fixing. So I tore that toy apart. Man, and then of course I couldn't get it put back together ever again right. Man, I stripped out screw holes and couldn't fix those. And had I just left it alone, I could have played with it. But right. The only thing now I had to do was play with the pieces and pretend that it was made whole. Pretend that it was a total and complete toy. But if the manufacturer had saw what I'd done to their materials, amen, they would have said, he done tore our toy up. But I want to say this to you. You know, if you want to be made whole in your life and you want your life to become complete, you've got to let God be the one to dictate to you how to do this. You got to let God show you solutions, because you may think, if I apply my intelligence to this, if I apply my knowledge to this, and I'm skilled in these areas, I'm trained in these areas, I've dealt with these kind of problems, I know what to do. But see, man does not know what to do. Man can see the water. Man can see the situation. Man can know that if I can just get this in my life, I will fix it. But see, there was no guarantee to this man, even if he got in the water, that he would get healed. He was just going by what he'd seen or heard and happened with others. But what he didn't know was he was laying right in front of the healer. You see, Jesus doesn't have to, man, sit down and talk to you and tell you, hey, man, you need to do this or do that. But once you accept him, what you will find out is he will just instantly begin to heal you, begin to fix your situation. He'll instantly, amen, he's able because he has the power, because this whole chapter, book of John, is about the power and the godly nature of Jesus Christ. It's about Jesus, who created all creation himself, to show and prove that he has the power. The reason why Jesus knows already every man's condition. He's already extended his olive branch, his hand out, offering help. But people are rejecting his hand because, amen, they want to do it themselves. I don't need nobody to help me. I'll do this myself. But see, the Lord reaches out, and he reaches out through his message. He reaches out through, amen, the preaching. He reaches out through, amen, the praise. He reaches out through the study of the Word of God, and through prayer and fasting and dedication. The Lord also has witnesses out here. People who have gone through troubles, tests, and trials that can witness to you, that can tell you based upon their experiences what God is able to do. Even when you look around in the earth of itself and you see his magnificent creation, it should be a witness and tell you that God is great and greatly to be praised. Also, God deals with people's minds. When you open your mind to receive God, he begins to talk to you and give you understanding. Sometimes in the middle of the night, he'll wake you up and reveal things to you that you have been worrying about, amen, all your life. So you know he's not somebody that's far away. The scripture tells us in Hebrews that we have not a high priest which cannot be touched ill with feelings of our infirmities. In other words, he's not so high that he can't feel what you're going through. He's not so high that he can't tell what your needs are, because it says further that he was like in all points tempted like we are, yet he was the one without sin. And so you should cast all your cares on him, church, because he really does care for you. You know, he's like a father. Hallelujah. Psalm said in 103 that pities his children, and God has pity on us. He sees and has compassion. even when we're suffering or going through. This man today was suffering a long time. Been 38 years in this condition. Some folks among us are suffering today. They're going through tests and trials long term. And I know in their heart they desire to be healed. But sometimes what's going on with you physically isn't really the problem, but it's what's going on with you spiritually and mentally. See, if you're going through something and your mind is right, you're in communion with God. If you're going through a test and a trial and you have the right attitude, then you're going to make it through that thing, even if it leads to death, because you really want to please God in all that you're doing or saying. You see, the Lord told him, I want you to rise up, take up your bed and walk. But the thing is, you have to know that immediately this man was made whole, and then he reached down and took up his bed and began to walk. We have men today and women in our society who are walking, but they're not walking in the Word of God, and they don't realize it, but they're extremely crippled in their walk, because from a spiritual side, they look broke down and bent over to me. They look crippled, not being the men and women that they could be if they would allow the Word to help them and strengthen them. But see, the Word of God, a man is counter to the desires of the flesh. The Word of God will make people stay where they are and even go back to what they went to rather than yielding themselves to the Word of God. See, they would rather be in control and playing with the pieces of a broken vessel than they would be having God controlling them as a whole human being, a whole spiritual body. You see, folks will rather stay where they are, rather endure what they're going through, rather do that than come and yield themselves and sit under the Word of God, knowing that they're going to have to change and be made conformable. You see, folks want to do what they want to do and yet claim they're saved. This man, I'm sure he was could brag to his friends. Y'all know I was at the pool. I was at Bethesda on Sunday morning. I was there sitting in row 3, 4, and 5, and the Word of God really came through and moved that place. And yet that person is sitting in the church, didn't get what they were supposed to get. Somebody else got blessed because they made the move, because they conformed themselves, because they changed themselves. Yet this person sitting right in the house of God came for the wrong reason. They came to hear a word because they said they needed a word. They came looking for healing because they'd gotten bad news for their doctor. They came because they had legal troubles. They came because they had lost their job and confused and didn't know which way to go. They came because they're having trouble in this home with their spouse, and they're on the verge of getting a divorce, or they done split, broke up, and left each other, and don't know what to do. Mama came or daddy came to church to request prayer for the child that's in a jail cell or somewhere in a hospital. See, they came to church for their own purposes and reason. But see, when you come to God, you've got to come because He is. You've got to come because you're willing to give up your whole soul, give up your entire life, let go of your own understanding, and lean on Him so He can direct your paths. When you come to God, you need to come to God because He is God, because He's deserving of your body. He's deserving of your mind. That's why you come to God. See, when you come to God with your own reasons, you're not going to get what God has for you, because you may think you're coming for one reason, but God have a whole nother purpose in mind for you. You may think you're coming because you want to get
get your healing and not understanding that God never intended to heal you. He's going to leave you in that condition for the rest of your life. But the reason he drove you into the house of God was to save your soul. It wasn't for what you thought. And so this man thought he knew the way to a type of salvation, thought he knew the way to a type of deliverance. But what he didn't understand was that Jesus did more than just heal him, because he did this on the Sabbath day. In other words, the day when no work was supposed to be done. It made the folks mad, and they began to wonder, amen, why and how this man was healed. You'll see that later on down below. And so this man, he had to check out Jesus. Even after Jesus had healed him, he had to check him out. Hallelujah. They wanted to know who it was. And he said, I can't tell you. I ain't seeing who it was. He didn't tell me who it was. I just know that he'd heal me. And Jesus found him later on as he completed the work, because now he began to deal with the real reason why he healed that man. And see, when God is doing something for us, the real reason isn't he's doing it for us, but the real revealed reason is to remove us from sin. And see, sin in your life will separate you from God. Sin will keep you from ever achieving the things that you could achieve or becoming what God had intended for you to come. And see, sin is the problem in our world today. I'm listening to these folks all talking about this man that went down into the church and killed 9 people. They say that because he was this or that, he was a racist, he was a demon possessed. But see, what they don't understand is he's a sinner. He did what sinners are supposed to do. And I'm so proud of that church family down there and how they represented God, because they said, we forgive him. And some folks is mad at him. What you mean you forgive him? He don't need to be forgiven. He need put to death. He need this and that. Well, you need the same thing, because you are a sinner too. But see, these folks, when they demonstrated what they demonstrated, they sent the message that America should see. America shouldn't see us rioting in the streets. Shouldn't see us pointing fingers and calling names of people just because of other colors or other races. This is not what men and women of God do. You have Dr. Martin Luther King, who had to have some God in him because of the example that he had set and how he dealt with the worst discrimination, the worst murders. He taught how to love. And you look at these shamsters today in the pulpit, encouraging people to hate other folks, encouraging people to separate and divide. It's not of God, but it's of the devil. And they need to be made whole. But you see, you have a whole segment of people who want to remain where they were. They want to remain in Birmingham in 1955. They want to remain in Arkansas in 1960. They still want to remain in Mississippi in 1945. But this is 2015. We're not back in the 50s or the 40s or the 60s. We're in a new place in a new time. And we may have been delivered instead of looking back in Egypt, the full nation. And it has much to offer. And we should be getting it by our examples, through hard work, through responsible citizenship, through being good fathers, not fathering babies out of wedlock. Our women should have the strength to say no. They shouldn't be acting like harlots out in the street. Men leaving the children at home, having 4 or 5 fathers in the household, and then wanting to blame somebody else. You see, the responsibility begins with you. If you want to stay like you are, you're going to be in the condition you are. You're going to be just like this man, never able to get healed, never able to get your blessing, never able to accept help. All excuses for everything that's going on. And I'm telling you, this is what sin has done. This is the work that sin has wrought. This is what happens when you live in sin, when you're constantly surrounding yourself in sin, when you have a form of religion but no power thereof. Somebody give God some praise this morning. Hallelujah. Somebody else's fault. Somebody else is the reason. I can't do it because I don't have this, I don't have that. What you don't have is you don't have the understanding of who you are. You've been taught to somebody that you're not. You've been told you can't do this. You can't achieve because of that. You've been told that you can't do because you have an infirmity. You see, I was born black. And being born black hinders me. It keeps me. Because everywhere I turn around, racism has me, and I can't ever get into the pool of blessing. You see, there's nobody to help me up out of being born in the ghetto. There's nobody to help me. And I got somebody holding me down every time I turn around. Well, I'm telling you, that's a lie. You're only bound because you think you're bound. You're only stuck because you think you're stuck. Man, what man is it that said unto thee, take up thy bed and walk? Who is it that told you that? Who is it that told you you don't have to stay in that condition? Who is it that told you that you could be healed? Well, today it's the preacher that's telling you. I am Ellen Henry Essex. That's who's telling you. And I'm telling you, you can get up out of that condition. You don't have to be stuck in the state that you're in. Do you want to be healed? Or do you just prefer to lay there like you are? Do you really want a change? Are you willing to take up your bed and walk? Are you willing to, if you got healed, you going to still stay where you are? Or are you going to try to do something with your life? If you're willing to do something, then God will help you do it. But if you're not willing, how do you expect to have a change? If you need milk in your refrigerator and you sit there on that chair and wait till somebody bring you some milk, you're going to be a wrinkled up, shriveled up old person. Man, if you want some milk, you need to get up, put some shoes on your crusty feet. Man, take yourself down to the store where they sell the milk. And then you need to have some money in your pocket to buy the milk. I guess if you ain't got no money, you're going to rob somebody on the way to the store. Is that how you're going to get your milk? If you had a job, you wouldn't have to worry about it because you wouldn't even have to walk. You could have bought the milk on your way home from work when you parked your car in the church parking lot. Don't you see what I'm trying to tell you? See, we have condition and we have people who believe that they are stuck where they are. They don't understand the power of the Lord. They don't understand that there are saints even in this church. God is blessed. Who worked? Who thought maybe they couldn't do certain things. Find out now. The world is there. Can I get a witness?
Amen.
Amen. That's right. Because the word, amen, when it first come out, it's not easily received or understood, but you have to act and operate on faith. Man, no wonder people are in the condition they're in when you got preachers blaming and telling them it's because of this and that. Man, they're lying. That's all I can say. I'm not going to sugarcoat it. They're absolutely telling a lie. You're not stuck where you are because of your color or because you were born in the ghetto. Man, we have great people who are in leadership who came from equally as bad, if not worse, conditions than you were in. What was the difference? They began to get them a book and pick up a book and figure out they needed to read. They began and educated themselves. And even though they were surrounded by all this mess that everybody else seemed trapped in, because they latched onto faith, latched onto the Word of God, man, God lifted them up out of that condition. Man, took them from the poorhouse all the way up to wherever they are. They got there because, and man, they believe, and it starts in your mind. If you want to stay trapped where you are, you can stay trapped. You can blame. There's plenty of folks you can blame. You can blame all you want. You can make all the excuses that you want. The opportunity is there for you. The choice is there for you to decide. But if you're tired and sick and tired of your condition, then stop doing what you've been doing. Come to the Lord. Man, come. Go to church. Start going back to church. Me and take your families to church. I don't care what you did last night. I don't care what you did the other night. Come to the house of God and hear the word of God. And find a house where the word of God is really being preached. Amen. Take up your bed and walk. So do you want to change? Think about it. Do you really want to change? Yeah, I know I need to do something. I know I need to do something. So many people are saying, right now, I know I need to do something. But how am I going to do it? How am I going to change? I don't have no education. I don't have this. I made some bad mistakes. I got these kids. I can't go to work. I can't do this. I can't. It starts with God. You're worried about things. I'm saying, do you want to just change? I'm not saying your situation or circumstance. I'm talking about you. Do you want to be made new? Do you want to be healed? Then get up. Come on. Let's just make the first step of going to God. Go to God first. Let Him deal with all the impossible things in your life that you have before you. Just make a commitment to give your soul to God. I'm not talking about a halfway. I'm talking about a real serious commitment. I can't quit smoking. That's a big one for a lot of folks. Well, why don't you come and let God help you? I can't quit. I'm hooked on alcohol. I'm hooked on drugs. Okay? It's just that's another manifestation of sin. You're looking at the things. I'm telling you, it's sin. If you give your life to God, truly let Him work on the sin part, cleansing you from sin, then all these other things fall off of you. You come because I need help with this. No, that's not what your problem is. See, the man's problem wasn't being lame. Jesus healed him to set an example to trigger a man the faith so that people could see. See, they looked at him, they couldn't see if the sin was removed, but they could see him walking. That's where the question came up. That's what caused all the problems. How in the world are you going to tell somebody that sins are forgiven? Only God can forgive sins. Then, you call me? You're Jesus. Yes, that too. You see, the whole point of your relationship with God, the whole point of your living, has to do with your relationship with Jesus versus your relationship with sin. And when you want to serve God, when you want to really serve God, then He'll change your whole attitude. Amen?
Amen.
God bless you all. Thank you. Hallelujah. I'm not going to stay like I am. I made that determination a long